Hello friends, myself Dr. Meena Sherawat, teacher educator in language education. I hope you remember that we have already discussed three methods. Yes, the grammar translation method, direct method, and audiolingual method. Today, we are going to start with structural approach. Structural approach, it means it is based on structure. Something around the structure. Yes, the structural approach to the teaching of a language is a technique by which students are taught to master the patterns of sentences, the stresses on the learning of essential structures of the language. Menon and Patel, they worked a lot on this method, and according to them, the structural approach is based on the belief that in the learning of a foreign language or a target language, mastery of structure is more important than the acquisition of vocabulary. It involves systematic presentation and practice of carefully selected and graded grammatical structures to the target language in effective and meaningful situations. Speech is mainly stressed, but reading and writing is not neglected. The primary tool here is the structure. So the teacher has to grade the structure as per the need of the students on the principle of teachability and frequency of use. Therefore, before selecting the structure, we should keep some principles in our mind. The principles are range of usefulness, simplicity, teachability, and productivity. The structural approach means the arrangement of words in such a way to form a suitable pattern. The study of sentence patterns is crucial in the structural approach. The sentence patterns, suppose in English, are organized around the verb, which is the most important part of the speech. The student is taught how to divide a simple sentence into a subject and predicate. For example, Garvit plays, ducks swim. So, subject and predicate. Here, subject is Garvit, predicate is plays. The next sentence pattern is subject plus verb plus object. But before teaching this, student should be aware with the nouns and pronouns which can be used as subjects and objects. So a teacher has to grade as per the level, as per the need of the students. For example, the boy kicked the ball. He finished his homework. A structure is a pattern, a particular arrangement of words to indicate grammatical meanings. It may be a word, a phrase, or a sentence. This method best suited for the early stage of teaching English, this approach. And this approach can be used as a technique in other methods also. The structural approach overemphasized oral work and speech manipulation. There is a blind repetition of structural item during oral teaching. And when we have repetition, and that to blind repetition, it means we are focusing on behavioristic perspective. This approach ignores reading and writing. Hence, children fail to expand their language acquisition. The proper working of the structural approach requires efficient teachers. Because a teacher has to decide and grade the structures as per the need and level of the students. Opportunities to learning English in school environment and inside the classroom have been greatly reduced. There is no room for developing proficiency in pronunciation because the main focus was on, yes, structures. Language being primarily a spoken thing is to be presented in its spoken form in the first instance. mastery over the system of English language is more important than the detailed knowledge of the forms. This mastery is best acquired by repetition and drill. The teacher's most important work is to create meaningful situation in the class. If the teacher is not able to create meaningful situation, then it will not work properly. The items must be firmly established by plenty of oral work before the students read in their books. According to Menon and Patel, there were some objectives of the structural approach. Let's focus on those. To lay the foundation of English by establishing through drill and repetition about 275 graded structures. So, there were about 275 graded structures which a teacher has to cover and select as per the need and level of the students. To enable the children to attain mastery over an essential vocabulary of about 3000 root words for active use. Active uses which we are able to use either in speaking or in writing. And passive is which we understand, that is, we know its meaning, but we are not frequently using those vocabulary. That becomes a passive vocabulary. To correlate the teaching of grammar and composition with the reading lessons. Next objective was, which they focused, to teach the four fundamental skills, namely understanding, speaking, reading, and writing in the order named. To lay proper emphasis on the oral approach. Professor F.G. French has also given some underlying principles for this structural approach. The first one is importance of framing language habits. It means this approach lays stress on the importance of forming language habit, particularly the habit of forming words in English. The learner should acquire the habit of arranging words in standard sentence patterns through language drills. Next is importance of speech. This approach, that is the structural approach, is based on the principle of effective use of speech, as it is more important than reading and writing. Speech is necessary means of fixing firmly all groundwork. Third one was importance of pupils' activity. Structural approach puts more emphasis on learner's activity than on the teacher's. It is the child who is the learner, so he must be actively involved in the teaching learning process. Next one is each language has its own grammar. Instead of teaching grammar of the target language, its structures are to be taught, as each language has its own grammar. This was the belief of Professor French. So, we can say that this method focused more and more on structures, and a teacher has to decide that and grade the level of the structures as per its usability, teachability, productivity. Now let's focus on the limitation of this approach. This approach is best suited for the early stage of teaching English. Structural approach overemphasizes oral work and speech manipulation. There is blind repetition of structural items during oral teaching. The approach ignores reading and writing, hence children fail to expand their language acquisition. Opportunities of learning English in school environment and inside the classroom have been greatly reduced. There is no room for developing proficiency in English pronunciation, which was the main focus in the audiolingual. But here, the main focus was on, yes, structures. So, this was the structural approach. Yes, now we'll be focusing on the next method. The next method on which we are going to focus is Communicative Language Teaching Approach. In short, we call it CLT. C for communicative, L for language, T for teaching. As we can say that in the previous methods and approaches, the major focus except on direct method was on habit formation, drill, practice, memorization. But now let's see what's there in this method. Communicative language teaching aims broadly to develop communicative competence in the target language. Yes, I know you may be thinking, what is this communicative competence? Communicative competence is the linguistic competence plus an ability to use the language appropriately in the real life situations. And what is linguistic competency? Linguistic competency is the knowledge of the rules and grammatical forms of the target language. So, here the focus was more on the interpersonal activities. Yes, on the interpersonal activities and the interaction. Language study has to look at the use, that is the function of language in the context, both its linguistic context and its social or situational context. So here the focus was on linguistic competence and the communicative competence. The teacher used to work on various activities in which she can generate more and more activities to accommodate students, or students can be asked to work in activities so that they can build up their own communicative competence. Unlike the audiolingual method of language teaching, which relies on, yes, repetition and drill and memorizing the dialogues, the communicative approach gives an opportunity to converse in real life situation, not to memorize the dialogues, but to develop the ability to converse. And it also motivates learners to communicate in meaningful way about meaningful topics. The communicative approach to language teaching is based on the first communicative principle, that is, activities that involve communication to promote the acquisition of language. Second one is the task principle. Task principle here means activities that engage students in the completion of the real world task, which can promote language acquisition. And the third one is the meaningfulness principle. Learners are engaged in activities that promotes authentic and meaningful use of language. So, communicative language teaching make use of real life situation that necessitate communication. The teacher sets up a situation that students are likely to encounter in real life. Real life situations are created for the learners. The situation must be real and the role must be real. Just because if we are just uttering few words and sentences is not a communicative competence, which involves the ability to react mentally as well as verbally in communication situation. Let me explain you with an example. For example, a teacher asks, what is your name? Or, is this a pen? Where do you live? This kind of empty talk is not communication at all, because this divorces language from communication. The need compels the child to invent the language. They should think and then answer. Answering, do you have a pen? Yes. What is your name? My name is Meena Sehrawat. Is not communication at all. In communication, the need should be there, which compels you to think and speak. Communication involves freedom and activity-based learning. The learner must be provided with sufficient exposure to the target language so that the learner gets a chance to manage himself and to explain his own new ideas in the language which is being taught to him. Learners acquire all the four skills through problem-solving activities. The main function of the language is to allow interaction and communication. What is the purpose of language? Why we learn language? We learn language so that we can interact with others. We can communicate with others. Therefore, classroom should provide opportunities for the rehearsals of the real life situations and provide opportunities for real communication. So, the approach should emphasize on, yes, instead of memorizing the dialogues, on creative role plays, simulations, projects, surveys, where our students can produce spontaneity and improvisations, not just repetitions and drills, because we cannot learn language through repetition and drill. Do we learn our first language through habit formation, repetition, or through drills? Yes, we try to use our first language, the mother tongue, in different situations, and that need compelled or made us to use that language at very ease. In this method, more emphasis is given on active modes of learning. Active mode means where the students are the active learners. And how can we include the students more and more? Yes, through pair work, group work, role playing, miming, dramatization, etc., which allows students to come forward and participate and use that language. And definitely, when we are using or trying to learn a new language, we'll be able to, yes, make mistakes. And this approach sees errors as a natural part of learning a language. Because we all learn through our mistakes. Learners trying to use the language creatively and spontaneously are bound to make mistakes and errors. And moreover, constant correction is unnecessary and should be discreetly noted by the teacher. We are not supposed to correct the student then and there. Let him do the error and first let him try to understand where he had done the errors. A teacher can note it down and afterwards they can discuss and she can explain how that can be, yes, corrected. Dialogues need not to be memorized but created by the learners in the given situations. And who is going to give the situations? Yes, teacher is going to give the situation and you can also welcome the students to bring different situations. Fluency and accuracy are seen as complementary principles underlying communicative techniques. At times, fluency may have to take on more importance than accuracy. In order to keep learners meaningfully engaged in language use, the role of the teacher is that of a facilitator and guide. What do you mean by facilitator and guide? Yes, teacher is not the authority. He is like a guide to the students. He helps the students in the different activities so that he can do well. So, there is a sort of democratic environment. Learning activities are selected according to how well they engage the learners in meaningful and authentic use. Therefore, before selecting any activity, a teacher has to think that how can I engage all the learners and which of the skills they'll be able to develop and enhance after using this activity. Emphasis is on the process of communication rather than on the mastery of language forms. The process of communication, they believe, is more important than the mastery of language forms. Learning is a process of creative constructions and involves trial and error. Definitely, when we are learning, even a child when starts walking, fails many times. But If he'll be scared of that, he'll never be able to learn how to walk. Similarly, when we are learning a language, definitely we may commit some errors and mistakes, but we learn through that. And whenever we are having some creative constructions, it means the trial and errors will be there. Communication involves integration of different language skills. It doesn't mean that this will only and only will be focusing on the communicative language approach, will be focusing on the use of different language skills, and they all are interlinked. Listening, speaking, somebody is reading, then writing. For example, a teacher gives you or asks you that you have to role play of a shopkeeper and a customer. Now she gives a total freedom to you to develop the dialogues as per your own creativity and imagination, and then using those dialogues in the role play. Some of the students are good enough, they just think and start speaking. But some needs time. They may think and write first and then read it, and then they are going to use those dialogues in the role play. But earlier in audiolingual, there were no freedom for the students to develop their own dialogues. They were given the dialogues and they have to memorize those dialogues. But in CLT, it gives you the opportunity to develop the dialogues or any other projects as per your imagination, your creativity, and then use it in the class or even outside the class. Because communicative competence does not mean that you are able to use that in the classroom situation. The real communicative competence is somewhat in which you can use that language outside the classroom. This method was most appreciated and still in use because it gives you the opportunity to use that language outside the class. But as we already have discussed, every approach and method is having some sort of limitations. Can you think of some limitations? Yes. If the class is overcrowded or the large class, it will be difficult for the teacher to monitor and facilitate the pair work, group work, and give individual attention to the students. This can be the thing. Communicative language teaching approach gives more emphasis on listening and speaking, because more emphasis on communicative competence in comparison to reading and writing. Though reading and writing are not neglected, but overemphasized are, yes, listening and speaking. Availability of competent teachers who can think of the authentic task and who have the command over the target language is again a limitation. Then even lack of infrastructure, as all the schools cannot provide the facility of language labs, teaching aids and other resource materials. So at times this is also considered as one of the limitation for the communicative language teaching approach. So how are you feeling? You will be able to use all these methods in, yes, in your teaching learning practice. Okay, learners. Okay, friends. Thank you.